Thank you, Sterling. Thank you to join us. We are continuing in our series about visioning, about where we're going as a church, and it's part three of a five-part series. Before I get into that, it's funny, as we were preparing this morning as a worship team, we just kind of felt and hoped that God would be ministering to your hearts this morning. I really felt that maybe someone might be coming here this morning with a giant over their shoulders, with something impossible on their shoulders. And we want you to know that Jesus Christ is able to break every stronghold. He is able to give you hope in your situation that is too big for you. So if that was you this morning and you want special prayer, come see me afterwards and I'll make sure that either myself or the other couple people, and we will pray for you so that you can feel the power of God in your life and witness his mighty right hand. He's your fortress. He's your stronghold. He is able. And we believe that. We believe that for real. So, just saying that. A little rant, pastor rant, stuff. Anyway, let's get back to our actual message. So, we're looking at onwards and upwards, moving forward as a church, what God has kind of revealed to us. It's kind of the vision that God came and gave us was giving God the love he deserves. Is our vision, where we're going, giving God the love he deserves. And then we kind of broke it down to three practical steps in which we're going to execute this as a church. The first was wildly loving Jesus. Wildly loving Jesus. I preached that a couple weeks ago. It's the fact that Jesus deserves our extraordinary love. And this week we're looking at wildly loving your community. Not like, you know, crazy walking up someone with Tim Hortons going, "Ah, here's your corner." No, but it's a extraordinary, what is different, what is beyond your normal comfort levels, wildly loving your community. What does that look like? Well, we come to Scripture, because that's where we find all our direction from. We come to Scripture in Matthew chapter 5, verse 13 to 16. And it's the story of salt and light. It says this, Jesus is explaining to his disciples, says, "You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot." Jesus said, you're a light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand. And it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, both as salt and light, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. So I read that scripture, and I know my son would say, "How do you make someone salty? They lose a video game and then they'd be salty." Yeah, see, he knows that's all about. But we're called to be salt and light in our communities. We're called to love them wildly in ways that they don't even expect. Ways that are positive and reaffirming. And so we look at this first illustration of salt, and we look at a Palestinian kind of salt. You know, I looked up some stuff about salt. NaCl is the chemical thing. I looked up some chemists who've talked in the scripture and said, you know, salt, the way we get it, you know, the sifto salt or whatever it is, you put it in boiling water and it adds flavor to your craft dinner. That's how you cook your craft dinner. Salt that we have, the compound NaCl, doesn't break down in water. But in the Palestinian salt, they didn't have these manufacturing plants. They got their salt sometimes from swamps. And so they got the salt, and with these certain sources of salt, they were highly impure, and which exposure to water could literally lose their saltiness, because the salt would be removed. It would actually need a white, powdery substance that looked like salt, but lacked the taste and the power of salt. And when I hear this, I always reflect back to Ann Morse, and she's my hero in this realm. We cannot afford a watered-down gospel. People need to know that Jesus Christ is alive and well and powerful and able to change your circumstances. Sometimes it's a matter of changing our minds about how we handle things, but he is able to make a difference. But if we preach a watered-down gospel, yeah, I'm going to heaven now, folks. But it's true. If we preach a watered-down gospel, how is anyone going to know how to get to heaven? because we know that Jesus Christ went to the cross and died for our sins, and that God desired to be in relationship with us so much that he made the way for us. It's not about a bunch of rules and regulations. It's about repentance. It's about turning our heart to Jesus and finding that when we follow him, we come into abundant life, true life, eternal life, even here and now. Doesn't mean we don't struggle, right? Sometimes we do struggle, but we've got someone to turn to. This substance looked like salt, but lacked the taste and power of salt. Maybe that's been your experience in church. I remember growing up in church. You know, you go there and sing a couple songs, and preacher preaches, you fall asleep, you wake up refreshed. Oh, it's a good night. Where's the power? Where's Jesus Christ? Where's Jesus Christ? Well, we believe that he hears our prayers. And if you want to see God making a difference in people's lives, come out to prayer meetings on Tuesday night. I shamelessly advertise that God meets us there. But anyhow, Hugh Halter is a guy about my age, and he has started a church in a different format. They don't even have a building per se. They are a church literally of small groups. They meet in small groups, and once in a while they come together and they meet together. It has a very Book of Acts style of church. Now, one thing I really like about Hugh Halter is he hasn't given up on the local church, on how things have gone, but he strongly suggests this idea of churches becoming churches of small groups. And that's one of the ways we're heading. But he says this, Hugh says this, in other words, talking about saltiness, how missional you are is largely determined by the extent to which your people and the pastor model life, activities, and words of Jesus. People need to see the real thing. They need to see Jesus really active in your life. Otherwise, we're just like that white powder. Looks like salt, doesn't taste like salt, and there's no power. We need Jesus Christ for real. So we're called to be salt in loving our communities, but we're also called to be light. You know, we live in a world of uncertainties. You know, we've got a couple of Yahoos in power. We don't know if there's going to be a big missile strike happen here. We don't know the state of our world from one day to the next. You could literally wake up tomorrow and your whole world would be changed. Well, I get thinking about that. Has anyone here ever prayed for revival at any cost? I've prayed for revival at any cost. I'm not saying God's going to make an ICBM or missile strike do that, but I am saying that when we pray a prayer and say, God, at any cost, we want revival. We don't know what he's going to do. We don't know how he's going to do it. But something like that would definitely awaken people's eyes to the fact that we have a certain amount of time here on this earth, and we need Jesus to be the center of our lives every day. But what I've noticed is that the darker it gets, the brighter light shines. The brighter the light shines, the darker it gets in our world, the brighter the light of Jesus Christ becomes. And there's a call to boldness. And the fact that we need to shine with boldness the love and light of Jesus Christ. There's a call as Christians to have an impact on our communities. To be salt and to be light. To be the tangible, touchable expression of God's love for this broken world. Jeff Bethke, I quoted him a couple weeks ago. He says, if grace is water, then church is an ocean. If grace is water, then church is an ocean. This is supposed to be a place where anyone and everyone can come and find the grace of Jesus Christ. He says, it's not a museum for good people. It's a hospital for the broken. Which means if you're a Christian in service of your king, you're all like the marshal, so you're all deputies, you're all nurses and doctors. And you need to know Jesus Christ in your own life. So you have something to give someone when they come in. It's not enough to give them yourself. You need to give them Jesus. So there's two things we need to figure out as we move forward, being the salt and light of the earth. Two things we need to figure out. One, if we're going to wildly love our community, we have to understand who our community is. Right? We can't just walk around the streets like, whoa, I love you, hugging people randomly. We'll be I do play video games, and one of the games I play is World of Tanks. And so, our pastor, spiritual man, plays World of Tanks. Yes, he does. So I get on there, and I'm with this community of gamers, and there's this one guy who leads our group, our platoon. He's got the most awesome southern drawl. He's like, "All right, boys, this is what we're gonna do." This is exactly how he talks. Maybe somebody can see this video and hit me. Anyways, Andrew, I want you to go up on that hill with Pipe 64. And he's just talking. I just love to listen to him talk. And all these guys, they're cursing and they're swearing and they're going on. You can tell they're ex-military guys. And so the other day they asked my brother, I said, "Oh, hey, Aaron, what do you do for a living?" "Oh," he said, "I move stuff." And I'm just thinking, like, is it my turn? Is it my turn? It's one of the things I love to do is just to be real with people, not to judge them, but just to be real with them. And when they be real with me and then they find out I'm a pastor, it is priceless. I love that moment. Because then they know I love them when their guard is down. I love them in their imperfection. And I love that moment because all of a sudden it's like they realize I've exposed myself to a pastor for the last 6 months, cursing and swearing, going on about all my sinful activities, and not once has he ever put me down. He's just loved and laughed with me. It's fun. It's fun. It's going to be the funnest thing you can possibly do is surprise them with your faith in a gentle and loving manner. And then they know you're real with them too. Who else is your community? Your neighbors. We're not very good at that as Maritimers. I think Maritimers used to be really, really friendly and stuff. And not that we're not friendly. It's just, you know, when someone rings the doorbell, it's like, high alert! Nobody move! Right? The doorbell just rang. Where the phone rang? Don't answer it. Maybe it's a telemarketer. We're a little oversensitive to those things. But how do we love our own neighbors better? You know, I get it pretty easy. George's brother lives no short of me, and he has honey, so I want to go see him. Yeah. Those who come across your path, they're your neighbor. Sometimes I ask myself, someone comes into my life, even for a few minutes, how and why did God put them in my path? So sometimes I'll start up random conversations with strangers in the weirdest of places, and I'll just see God, is there an opening here for me to share my life or share a story or to be a blessing? Or, I shared a couple weeks ago that sometimes I'm just nice, but sometimes I forget to take it the next step. But I'm practicing, I'm learning to love people better, and so should we all. So who's your community? Basically anybody you bump into. But there's some people you need to be intentional about. So yeah, beep, beep, I'm a milk truck. Okay, I've got his head stuck in there. So how do we love others? How do we love others? And why is there a cow picture here? Well, let me explain. In the book, The Shaping of Things to Come by Alan Hirsch and Michael Frost, the authors provide a metaphor of how the blessing of the gospel naturally attracts others. The blessing of the gospel. The blessing of Jesus Christ naturally attracts others. Why? Because the real power of Jesus Christ attracts cold, dead, hard religion, pushes people away because people are smart. The authors are from Australia, and in the vast outback region, ranchers are unable to control their livestock using fences. It's just too big to keep the fences intact. The alternative approach is to simply provide accessible wells where the animals learn to find relief for their thirst. The ranchers know that if the well is the only place of refreshment and survival, the animals will naturally stay close to it. And Jesus Christ is the answer to so many issues and things. But we need to know what those blessings are in our own lives. And then we need to determine, how do we love other people? How do we give these blessings to other people that we've received ourselves? So we have to become versed in the ways that people receive love. This is the best tool ever, 5 Love Languages. Just go online, you can take a test yourself, and you can find out how you like to be loved. And it's important to know that, because you naturally love other people the way you're loved. See, not everyone likes to be loved or receive love the same way you do. 5 Love Languages, let's go over quick. Words of affirmation, you know, saying nice things to someone. Physical touch, You know, just be aware of your surroundings. Not everywhere approves of physical touch. You know, certain school systems, sometimes youth groups have a no-touch policy, so be aware of that one. But, you know, even still those things, even as a pastor, before I pray for someone, I always ask, do you want to put my hand on your shoulder? Not everybody's comfortable with that, right? So we've got to be sensitive to that. There's acts of service, you know, raking leaves or doing the dishes, which I have to do when you go. Not the raking, thankfully, all the others. Gifts. Some people really like to receive gifts. Other people just plain old like quality time. So these five love languages, becoming versed in them and expressing love both individually and, you guessed it, in our small groups, which we're going to start referring to as discipling groups, discipling communities. Because, you know, Jesus has called us in Matthew 28 to become disciples and to make disciples, right? And so these discipling communities are going to be one of our main strategies. And so we talked about this earlier, that Hillcrest, we want to become a church of small groups. Before we get to the small group parts, let's look at how you individually can be practicing loving others. You know, how about this? When you come to church, do you come with a missional attitude? Do you come to church looking to see if you can love someone in one of those five ways? Maybe it's when you first get to church, maybe if you're one of the first people out of the church, you look at all those nice parking spots right close to the door and say, yes, I got here first, I got a nice parking spot. What if you saved that for someone who hasn't been here before? Oh, I don't know, maybe. Going to work? How about when you go to work with a missional attitude to love someone, keep your eyes open at work to love someone today in one of those five ways? Maybe it's Patrick working with Mark and Candy, right? Maybe he brings them coffee every day. I don't know, maybe, if they get lucky. Being at home, when you're home, with an attitude, you have an attitude and outlook to serve your family in one of those five ways. You know, our families are so precious to us. When you're at play, do you look at opportunities to love someone in those five ways? Maybe someone, you know, you may be playing basketball, someone took a three-point shot and they missed horribly. You know, maybe it's just that pat on them on the shoulder and say, hey, good effort, man, right? Instead of ripping them, tearing them apart, right? You need to see everyone who walks through the doors of your life differently than you ever have before. You want to wildly love them. You need to look at them like you do your own family. Unless you're not getting along with your own family, then look at them differently. Look at them like you do your own loved ones. Sometimes when I meet someone, I one of the things that comes across my heart as a pastor is their mother is praying for them. Their mother is praying for them. I don't care if their mother's going to church or not. I know moms. I know how moms work. They pray for their kids. And when I come across someone, I don't judge where they're at. I think to myself, hey, I go in this situation, I've got mother's prayers backing me up. Right? No matter how unlovable, tough, annoying, dirty, clean, polished, or whatever the person's like, remember that Jesus died for them. And everyone's praying for them. Maybe you could be the answer to prayer. I'm pretty excited about something we're going to try in the new year. Love in Action. Kathy Baird has that team up. I got thinking, and we got thinking, how can we do Love in Action even better than we've ever done it before? I feel this year we've even got it going better. But in the new year, we decided to ask in our church for a little bit more. The budget meeting's coming up. And one of the things we asked for was some more money so that you as an individual, if God gives you a brainy idea, that you want to love someone or you want to love a group, but you just don't have the money yourself to do it, you can be empowered to do it. We believe in you. We believe in the power that God has put in each of you as an individual to make a difference in your community. Maybe you're at somewhere and you think, man, I would love to just bring a little big box of Tim Hortons coffee to these people because, you know, the people at the service station, they serve me so well, and they're working really hard, I can tell they're busy. I want to bless them, but maybe I just don't have the extra funds right now myself. But what you're going to be able to do in the new year is you're going to go talk to Kathy, you're going to talk to Love and Action team, And, you know, we're going to have an accountability situation, so it's not like, you know, I'm like, man, that wife of mine's amazing, I just want to buy her a cake. You know, and, you know, there's accountability, I won't be able to do that. But, you know, if you have a missional idea, there's a people you want to bless, but you just don't have the funds, you know, we want to empower you as a people to begin to imagine and to think about how you can bless other people. You know, it'd be, I guess, it'd be ironic if we brought Heidi too much coffee at work. That'd be really weird. But bring it from another Tim Hortons and bring it over. She gets it for free. Okay. But we want to say thank you to a neighbor or a teacher or someone new moved in, but you just can't afford a pie. Or maybe your baking skills aren't so great and you don't have access to skills like Len Baird has. You know, maybe you want that extra help. Well, we want to empower you to love your community wildly. So our discipling communities, our small groups, this new way of being Hillcrest, of getting together in small groups, I think how effective it could possibly be is if in our small groups we realize they're not just Bible study groups. It's not just about the teaching time. That's obviously going to be part of it because we want to grow spiritually. But we also want to be known and to know others and develop deep relationships. And you know what happens when you develop deep relationships? It doesn't happen overnight. You start to share concerns. You will start to hear things that maybe only the pastor would hear because suddenly you've got these relationships developed, and then someone says, you know, my mom's in the hospital. She's really hurt. Suddenly, you don't need the pastor to tell you. You should probably go visit their mom. Suddenly, in your heart, there comes this welling up, and you want to do this because you love that person, because you develop a relationship. Maybe someone in your group breaks their foot and they just can't manage the kitchen. And Angela says, I will bring you food. She's good at that. Right? Maybe someone will see another need and you'll come together and you'll pray for one another in a deeper way. Maybe as a group, your heart will be burdened for a neighbor and you'll go rake their leaves or shovel their snow. But these community, discipling communities that we're going to have in place, we're hoping you'll buy into. They're going to be key to make this happen because there's only so much we can do as individuals. It's the reason we have church. It's the reason we have associations. It's the reason we have a convention of Baptist churches. You can only do so much by yourself. You need a team. You need support. You need people praying for you. We don't want these discipling communities to be just Bible studies. We definitely do not want them to become cliques or holy huddles. We want you to get into each other's lives and make a difference together in the people who are important to you. I think each individual group is going to have a different kind of chemistry. Each group is going to be unique. Why? Because you've got unique people in it, with unique problems, and unique gifts. There will be things that you can do to reach your very own communities together. You know, be intentional. Maybe it's a movie night, and you intentionally invite some people over to show that, hey, you're just normal people and you like a good movie. Again, Hugh Halter says this. We may not always feel it when building a deck for someone, shoveling snow, helping out financially, watching a neighbor's kids, opening our home, or giving gifts, but these habits and activities do create a well, back to the cow, do create a well that people will eventually gravitate towards because they will have experienced the blessing of Christ in your life for themselves. The advantages of being part of a discipling community is this. You know, it's actually a lot less scary to invite someone to your home or to someone's home than it is to a Sunday morning service. A discipling community is a safe place to invite someone to kind of get to taste from the well. A discipling community can target a specific need for a specific season. And that will help the pastoral staff immensely. A discipling community can help you reach your community because you don't have to do it alone anymore. And a discipling community, and this is where it really helps, can hold you accountable to be more intentional with your time to reach out to people. You don't need your pastor's permission to love people. You won't necessarily need, and you don't necessarily need my help to love your own family and friends. I do and I will. But there's a lot of you now. And we are growing. And I need you to have the support that you need. If I could clone myself, we're probably 20 years away from my clone actually being able to help. So we need something else better than that. You know who we need? You. We need you. We need the people sitting in your pew knowing you and your situations. And we need Jesus Christ to empower you to be bold, to be the salt and the light in your sharing. In closing, I'll ask the worship team to come up. Dr. Gary Glanville says this: Christ challenges us as his followers to be the salt of the earth, to add our flavoring, and I say, to add our love wherever we go. He says, this is why I think it is so important for us as Christians to make sure our behavior is above board. We are to behave like pure white salt, unadulterated by this world, holy in character, and honest in our dealings with others. He says we make sure our language or the stories we tell are not questionable. And this is kind of where he gets into. He says we are to bring a cheerful spirit to our work environments, while at the same time working diligently and honestly. We're to offer compassion and kindness, filling needs to those we meet in mission. In a worried world, we offer the calmness and reassurance of Christ. In a depressed world, we bring the joy of Jesus. In a frightened world, looking for answers, we offer the hope of Christ. As salt, we're not only preservers of that which is good, but we are also agents of change, because we want to change that which is about us into something better. Therefore, this world, our communities, need us. So let's commit ourselves to wildly loving our communities, and let's pray. Heavenly Father, you know that there's still a little bit of work to be done before we can get our disciple communities up and running. But Lord, you've called us into mission with you because you love this world. And you have called us to partner with you in loving people wildly. So Lord, give us boldness. Help us to be the light. Help us to be the salt that has the ability to be like a well, where people can partake of the blessings you put in our hearts and our lives. And Lord, let us be a blessing to people around us. We pray these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand as we sing. I need to say, it starts, everyone needs compassion. Amen.